I welcome everyone present here with us. I hope that you are safe and taking the required precaution and practicing the new normal. We are not unknown to the tech digital transformation that has been taking place in the society. Hence, we need to upskill ourselves for the digital world and prepare for future, which is why FIPI PDPU student chapter has organized a 2-day workshop on data visualization masterclass that is going to be conducted by Mr. Dhawal Patel. I feel pride as I say that he is an alumnus of the 2011 to 2015 batch of BTech Petroleum Engineer in PDPU. He is a technical data professional with over 5 years of experience at Royal Dutch Shell. In this session, we will learn about data visualization from the basic to advanced level, data analysis, dashboard creation, and hands-on data input, processing, and visualization development. The session will be followed by exercise and assignment. Participation certificate of the workshop will be delivered to via your registered email ID. However, please keep in mind that the completion of the exercise and assignment is must to get the certificate. Before we start to the session, I would like to request all of you to keep your mics muted during the session in order to avoid unnecessary disturbance. Before any further ado, I would like to request Mr. Dhawal Patel to begin with the workshop.
Well, thank you, Jatin. Thanks everyone for joining in. Just making sure everyone can hear me clearly.
Yes, sir.
All right. Okay, I'll start then. Okay, we have over 50 participants, so that should be fine. Okay, let me just make it slideshow. Again, making sure everyone can see the screen as well.
Yes, sir. You can start.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
All right. Jatin, I would just request you, go off the video. A video is not required. So thanks for introducing.
Okay. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay. Okay, so we basically have 2 days session. The plan is to have 3 hours each day, today and tomorrow, on data visualization masterclass. We'll try to cover all the topics, but I'm not sure whether we'll be able to go full 3 hours because it's a long time. I have particular topics in mind, which if I'm able to cover, we can close the call, even if it is 2 hour or 2.5 hour. And if you have more questions, that's wonderful. We can go over 3 hours as well if everyone agrees. So data visualization masterclass, I have 5 years of experience in data visualization. So I thought I would be in a good position to, let you all know of what are the intricacies and how data visualization can be used in fact, any kind of industry, but mainly pertaining to petroleum industry because that is where I belong. I am just presuming few things, like most of the audience is from oil and gas background. If not, that's not a huge challenge as well. I'll try to explain each and everything. One more presumption is I'm presuming most of the audience is from India, but in case we have outside Indian audience as well, that should be fine. I'll explain the examples from that perspective as well. Without further ado, as Jatin mentioned, let's just start. We can start with safety moment. I am just hoping that everyone is fine at their home, doing well. You are taking all the necessary precautions that are required to be safe. At house as well, you are taking care of each other and know the emergency exits in your house so that you are safe all the time. We are not out of the COVID crisis. So please follow all the rules and regulations that government has mandated. And from your sanity, just be sure that you are virus free. All right. And some reminders on the virtual meeting. I would love to come to PDPU again and give this session face to face, but unfortunately we are not in any kind of situation. So being in virtual meeting, just make sure, as Jatin mentioned, I'm sure you won't do that, but if you're not talking, just be on mute, and if you want to talk, just go on unmute and ask any questions, right? It is promoted. Asking questions is promoted because 3 hours is a long time for me to talk. And if I have a lot of questions, we can have an engaging session. All right. If you have some mobile calls or anything, feel free to attend that. But just make sure that it is not creating any disturbance. Okay, I'll start with my introduction. As Jatin mentioned, I belong from PDPU. I graduated in 2015. I had graduated in petroleum engineering, major in upstream. Well, it was not a very good time to get graduated that year, but yeah, I had started in 2011, so I had to finish that. Well, yeah, I held the second rank, but yeah, so I, from my experience perspective, I joined Shell directly after my graduation in 2015. I was there as process data engineer, mainly working on data solutions for Shell. So Shell Chennai, you might be knowing that Shell Business Operations Chennai is having its own data analytics and data solution team. So I'm a part of that. Then I got promoted to technical data specialist in 2018. More or less the role remained the same, but then the responsibility was more, mainly delivering to various assets where Shell is operating and is having some interest to solve their data issues or to provide them better business insights. Then recently I became team lead for Wells Resource Assurance and Reporting Team and Central Reporting Services Team. Some personal thing about me, I like sketching, I like painting. I am a volleyball player and I'm from Ahmedabad, Gujarat. Any questions till now before we directly jump into the topic? Okay, 5 seconds of silence. I'll take that as yes or no according to my convenience. All right. So here I take no. I'll just move on. Again, I'll just remind you, please make the full benefit out of this 3 hour session that we have today. It's highly voluntary from my side, and I'm just wishing that you guys should be knowing some technology which is being used in today's world, and it is in very high demand. So just to skill you guys up, because you might be knowing that if you belong to petroleum industry, the situation is not very good due to recession and oil prices. So it's always good to learn something new, and data visualization is in fact well, simplest thing to learn to start with. Okay, all right. So in today's agenda, this is the complete agenda for the workshop. We have done safety briefing, personal introduction I have given. What we will look into for today is till this point. Sorry, I skipped. Can I have a marker somewhere? Let me just check out. Okay, so the plan is we'll be dealing with dashboard creation. That's the plan for today. We will be looking till the dashboard. Okay, I'm messing things up. Okay, so we'll start with where does data visualization fits in data world. It is an important part, but we need to understand where it fits in the overall data life cycle. You might be hearing a lot of things about machine learning, AI, data processing, data solution, business intelligence, data analytics, and so on. So we'll just have a look where data visualization fits in. We will be looking at some basic visualization. We'll go into some advanced visualization as well. Then some of my favorite topic, like how do we explore data and do analysis on that? How can we better storytell so that the audience is engaged in what you are saying? One way of storytelling is interactivity. We'll be looking at that as well. Then we'll look into dashboard creation. Dashboard again is accumulation of various visualization to portray a picture or to portray a situation. So that is dashboard. We'll look into that. How do we create dashboards and what are the steps to follow, or care, or basically tips and tricks to create dashboards. All right. So that is today's agenda. Tomorrow we'll be looking into hands-on. I'll just mention what are the industry tools from data visualization or data analysis perspective. What are the various tools and what we will be using for the 3 hours. At the end of this session, today's session, I'll just mention what are the steps for tomorrow, right? So no need to worry about that. We'll look into hands-on data input. How do we input the data? How do we process the data? And finally, how do we visualize and analyze the data? We'll be having some exercises today as well, and after tomorrow session as well. You can get in touch with the organizer of this session, when to submit, and all the proceedings further. Okay. Is there any other topic that you guys expect and want to add to this agenda? We can very well do that. So I'll open the floor for 1 minute. If anyone is having any concerns with this agenda, or if anyone wants to add anything new. Okay, so I am assuming that the topics are on point and there does not seem to be any change, right? Okay, so I am not getting any confirmations. We have a very silent crowd. By the way, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Hello. Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Good afternoon. This is Kirpal Patel. I just want to add one or two points. Like, can you just give some insight about the machine learning and the artificial neural network that you are doing currently, or some part of your team are doing?
Well, that's a good idea. So if we have time today, I'll just tell my story of what kind of machine learning things I'm involved in, or what are my plans for from that perspective.
Sure. And some good example and some exercise maybe there, so it's really good for us.
Sure. Okay. So we have a very diverse crowd, I understand, and it's okay to ask. But I'll make sure that whatever everyone understands, we'll do that, right? So of course, at the end of the session, I'm sure that we'll be having some time and we can discuss some aspects of machine learning. Well, it's a very huge topic, but we can always have a start. Okay,
sir.
All right, thank you. Okay, any other comments?
Hello. Hi, sir.
Yes. Yeah.
Sir, are we dealing with the regression analysis and the pivot table that you have completed in your previous webinar? Okay.
Well, that was from the analysis part. In this sessions, we'll be focusing mainly on visualization. Of course, pivot table is one of the example of visualization. So we'll be looking into that. Yeah. Once in our hands-on, we will be using a special data visualization tool and try to create a pivot table And as Kripal mentioned, if we can touch base on some machine learning aspect as well, so that we can see regression there as well. Yeah?
Right, sir. Okay.
Cool. All right. Any other comment before we move on?
So the tool you're using is Power BI for visualization.
We can do Power BI as well. But what I plan to do is, since I have a lot of experience in Spotfire is one such tool. But we'll come into that when we do industry tools overview.
Okay, sir. So I wanted to know that how to publish our file, whichever we have like completed, we have analyzed and we have created the visualization charts. So after that, how can we publicize it to our teammates? So okay. if that point we can cover in Spotfire as well, no issues.
Yeah, sure. So that is in plan. We'll be looking into how to publish our reports. Yeah. All right. Okay, I'll just move on now. And here we are starting with the workshop topic. All right. So our first topic is, where does data visualization fit? So this, all of this, few slides, it is created from the perspective that you will get some interest, and it will be mainly theory, but just bear with me. And if you have, again, from practical perspective, if you have any question, just bring forth. Okay, so I was mentioning where does data visualization fit in data world, right, or data lifecycle. So in my previous session, which I had on the various aspects of data in petroleum industry, I had shown you what is raw data and what is information. So let's just again touch base, what is raw data and what is information. So you might be knowing that data can be anything, but once your numbers start making sense, it becomes information. And then you have business insights out of it, and it becomes knowledge. But to start with, we always have raw data in our hand, which are numbers without any sense to it. But from our business understanding, we make sense of the data, and that data becomes information. And then information becomes very crucial for any decision making in an industry. Right. So that is raw data and information. If we talk about any system, let me again slide share. Okay, so when we talk about any system, a system will always have three components: input, processing, and output. In terms of data, we always say that how can a data be entered, right? It can be through various hardware, it can be through softwares, or people can manually enter that. For example, if you have ever visited a group gathering system, there will be a lot of meters and measuring gauges, right? So from there, let's say it is measuring every 10 minutes, what is the pressure and temperature. So that becomes input from the hardware and software. Whereas let's say you have not that system, like in group gathering system, I hope everyone understands what group gathering system is. It is basically where the oil gets accumulated from various wells, and then it gets processed. So let's say we don't have such hardware and software which directly enters the data into the system. Then people have to go there and manually check the pressure and temperature every 10 minutes or every hour, and input in the system. So people, software, and hardware constitute of all the components which can enter the data into a system. Right. And then the data is then stored somewhere, and the data visualization basically comes into picture where we have information or report generation. Right. Once the data is collected, it's still in the raw format. It is not information as such. But when someone, let's say some data analyst or some business analyst comes there, or data analyst is the prime example of who does that. So let's say data analyst come there, and from the data collection, he or she gets all the data and reports or generates a report out of it, saying that throughout this year, the pressure has been increasing or decreasing through this trend line. Then it becomes an information, right? That information can be used in various decision making, like if we have, let's say, very less pressure during winter season, then we need to make sure that next year that does not happen and the pressure is optimum. Right, so that is a business decision that we have taken from our information, right? And once we have generated our reports, we can very well publish it in the form of information and reports again. And that is where someone asked, how do we publish the report? And we will be looking into that as well. How we publish the report or dashboards, all right? Okay, so that is system. From data life perspective, data life cycle perspective, we know that we can create the data, collect the data. We can store the data. We can share and process the data as well. We'll be looking into a lot of data steps or processing steps when we go ahead with this workshop. Then we come into data visualization part. So this is where the data visualization comes into picture, like how we can explore the data on our own and how we can analyze the data to make better decisions. Then we can publish the results, publish the data or reports. We can archive the data and reports again. And if you want to reuse it, we can reuse it and the cycle goes on, right?
Sir, what is MIS?
MIS is Management Information System. Thanks for that question. MIS is Management Information System. That means we are building a system where we manage our information. All right. Is that clear? MIS?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. So basically, MIS is again the system where we create a system where we can reuse the data and generate the reports on the fly. And basically, we are managing the information in the best way. Right? Okay. So this is the life cycle of data, how it looks. And again, when we talk about tools, right? When we talk about tools, let's say Power BI, Tableau, we have a lot many, ClickView, SpotFire, and so on. What we does is that tool will be used in data processing. Main part would be in the data exploration and analysis. We can publish the data and we can archive the data as well, right? So in this four steps, we can use the data visualization tools like SpotFire, Power BI, and Tableau. Oh no. All right. Okay, so now I'll move to next slides. Do we have any questions on this slide? Because this is pretty much the basic of how the data flows throughout the cycle. Yeah, this is pretty basic. All right, so now let's move on to some of the visualization, which I find intriguing and would be a good set of visualization to start with, which will be interesting. Well, I guess it will be interesting. So let's just move on. Okay, there can be a lag. Is this slide visible where we have a very colorful chart?
Yes, sir.
All right. So now let me just explain this graph. It might not make sense in the first look, but if you have seen this, this is a very interesting visualization. Now what it says is we have a collection of data from various artists or poet, literature, literate, and so on, right? So we have this famous personality and their daily schedule is being represented in a form of visualization. Right. So now what it shows is, let's say John Milton. Yeah? John Milton. For John Milton, the day, well, he sleeps till 4 a.m. only. Yeah? Then he does some other work. Then he has some food and leisure time. Then at 7, he really 7 in the morning, he really starts his creative work, and that is the only creative work he does for the day till 12 p.m. And then on, he is more or less like us, chilling out throughout the day. Yeah, so that is just one example, John Milton. But now see how powerful this visualization can be, right? We can see for the first person, he does creative work a lot. And in the night, in fact. So his creative uses starts running in the night. And he does most of his work, creative work, in the night from 1 a.m. to let's say 8 a.m. and later in the afternoon. And some people like Sigmund Freud, he prefers to work in the afternoon and evening and rest of the day. Well, he is also doing a day job. So here we can very well see that which people, wherever we have greens, we have people who does daily job as well, along with their creative work, right? So one, let me just take one more example. Let's say, who is typical? So let's say William Styrian, right? So that person is having more or less like our schedule. He sleeps at night, does his daily job for just 1 hour, and then does creative work, and more or less he is having leisure time, right? He does not exercise at all. So we can see that there are very few people who does exercise in the day, and rest of them, they does not do. So now what, in just one visualization, you can understand how much information we are getting and how much insights we are getting, right? So if you want to judge a person, we won't do that. But if you want to judge a person, we can very well see that how much sleep a person is getting, how much work is a person is doing, whether he or she is doing exercises or not, how much leisure time, like this person, Mary Flannery O'Connor, is having a lot of leisure time. Well, on the funny side, we would be wondering how that person got famous, but still. All right. So this is one type of visualization. We can, let's move on. any thoughts on this? Before we move on?
No, sir.
All right. Okay, so we'll be moving on to some other examples. So if you follow Indian politics, apologies if you are not non-Indian, but I'll try to explain. The first visualization is from the general election of 2019, and we can see the trends at 11 a.m. how, in which party's favor the seats were. So each dot represents a party, and from the politics perspective, the target is 272 out of the total. And if we are if the party is beyond that target, you are in the winning range. So typically in 2019, what we saw at 11 a.m. was for BJP is a party. For BJP, it was winning at 11 a.m. And we can very well see that they are in majority. Now others and Congress had, but they were in minority. Can anyone tell me why this kind of visualization, or why he chose semi-circle for this visualization? And it is very well suited for this visualization.
Sir, the middle line can easily tell the results who is heavier.
That's correct. Yeah, that's correct. So it kind of work like a speedometer, right? If you are beyond 50%, you are winning. That's a correct thought process. Any other thoughts why this type of visualization was selected?
Sir, the data must be dynamic. Like it's at 11 a.m. So at 12 p.m. it must change. Yeah. So the trend must also change at 12.
Yes, that's correct. So let's say at 12 a.m. the BJP seats, they are losing their seats. So dynamically, the visualization or the dots will turn to gray or blue, right? Any more thought? I have one thought which is still I'm looking for. All right. So the thought behind this is what I thought. I don't know whether this guy has, guy or girl has created this visualization, keeping that in mind. But this actually represents our parliament. So if we see, it's in the form of parliament. Our parliament sits in a semi-circular format, and they sit like this only. What I guess is from one side, they will the ruling party will be sitting. And that's why from one side, they have started the majority. So that is in one go, we can very well say that this visualization is having something political, because it signifies parliament as well, right? And indeed, it gives us the election results. All right, so that is one. Now let's come on to the other visualization, right, which is from the Disney. And well, we always are after the D&I, the diversity and inclusion, right? And we always say that in a movie, how much is the role for female, right? And how much is the role for male? Now we see that in most of the movies of Disney, well, very critical and not so good, a lot of movies of Disney is having 60% or more of the lines spoken by male, which is weird. We can see that in Jungle Book, 98% of the line were of male, and very less, 2% were from others. So this visualization, how powerful that it can be, right? Because it says that lot many movies, when we compare to the right side, we have some movies, very few movies, where we have women speaking 60% of or more lines. But we can also see that, yeah, Inside Out, Alice in Wonderland, Maleficent, and Sleeping Beauty is having a lot more contribution from the women. And there are some movies which is having a gender balance, which movies like Frozen, The Incredibles, Tangled, Tarzan, and so on. Right. So this can be a very powerful visualization to basically be transparent to the world. Right. Now you can see that once this report has been published, Disney might have faced some consequences about this as well. But yeah, the visualization represents a correct picture of what they are doing, and they might be striving now to make a gender balance. So that is a decision that Disney might be taking out of this visualization. Right. Any questions so far? Or someone tried to review. Yeah, go on.
Yeah, sir, for the election results data visualization, if the you said right, the seat position is the only sole reason why we have gone for a semicircle. So what if that would not be the reason? So we can like pretty well do it with a straight line, right?
Well, we can do. There are a lot of ways, and that's a good thought of in what other ways we can visualize it. But what I meant was, it is one of the thought of representation, right? Others mentioned like we can have 50% is very clear in this kind of visualization. In bar chart, it would be difficult. And that's a correct assumption as well. So there are many thoughts which might have went into the designing of this visualization, right? So that is not the sole reason. We have a lot of reason. But if we look, pie chart can also be a good, very simple visualization to do this, right? Because there also very, very well we can see that 50%, over 50% BJP is going. So that is, if we are showing proportion, we will look into that to show proportion, which is the visualization which are best.
Right? Yes.
Okay. But these are some sophisticated visualization, and I like them pretty much. All right. Okay. Let's now move on to some other visualization. Am I missing anything? No. So what I did was, I went to Google and typed COVID. Now you can see that how the world is changing, right? Earlier, let's say in 1990s, if we had typed anything like this before, then we would have got results in a very data format, like click this link, this country is having this many number of cases, this country is having this many number of cases, and so on. But now the world has changed, and now I can see that with a simple search of COVID, I can see three visualization on the first page itself. And here we can see that line chart is showing for India how many number of cases are there on a daily basis. Yeah, new cases on a daily basis. Well, it's very scary. But yeah, we can see that there are some crests and troughs as well. If we want to be positive, we can see that in last couple of days it has reduced, and so on. Yeah, so we have line chart. I did not notice this. I belong from Gujarat, so it is just showing me Gujarat result. But again, it's on a map chart. Yeah, so Google, what it does is it gets your location and tells you your relevant data. If you are from Gujarat, you might want to see Gujarat's result first, right? I can deep dive into India, I can deep dive into US's results as well, but first it has just prompted me Gujarat's result, like how many number of cases there are. And then we have a kind of KPI chart. So if you understand KPI, KPI is key performance indicator. It's a new kind of visualization and is very widely used. It basically tells us what are the KPIs, like total cases, recovered, deaths, what are the number of those in a very crisp manner. Yeah. In India, we can see, in Gujarat, we can see worldwide, what's the situation. So, yes. Okay, so we have three. So this is just a simple search, and I was sure that when I write anything like that, it will show me visualization instead of data. And I was right. Okay. Any questions on this? Because we saw three kind of visualization here.
Sir, please repeat KPI charts.
Yeah, yes. All right. Yeah, so KPI means key performance indicator. Let me take an example. So let's say you belong to a company. Let's take an example, XYZ company. And the key performance indicator means, let's say, what is the profit for this year? What is the sales for this year? What is the revenue for this year? Yeah. So if those are the KPIs, key performance indicator, in a very crisp manner, it will show me that what is the profit, what is the revenue, what is the sales for this year, for last year as well. So basically KPI chart is nothing but a very summarized manner of what we want to see actually. And on basis of what we will be making our decision. Right? So that is KPI chart. So here, let's say from COVID perspective, the KPI from our understanding are total cases, key performance indicator, how many have recovered, how many deaths are there. So if I belong from government, on basis of this, I can make some decision, right? Let's say if the deaths has increased many fold from last month, we need to make some decisions and so on. Like I need to have some lockdown kind of thing. All right, so that is KPI chart. Okay.
Sir, is KPI charts always in the tabular form?
Well, it can be in a very colorful format as well. It's not necessary that it is in a tabular format. But what we need to make sure is it's very crisp. It will be having a title and it will be having some number.
Right, sir. Sir, you are calling the overview, that box as the KPI charts, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, sir.
Okay. All right, let's move on. So if you belong to oil and gas industry, some of the visualization you might have already seen. And let's just refresh our memories, right? If you don't belong to oil and gas industry, don't bother. In your branch, you will be having your set of visualization again, but I'll just try to explain. All right. So we have decline curve analysis. You might have already studied this. If not, you will study the decline curve analysis. It means that day on day, how much production rate will be reducing, because we know that once we open a well, the production will be high, but then the pressure will decrease, and along with that, the rate, flow rate will also decrease. Yeah, so this is a representation, visual representation of how my day on day, the flow rate is decreasing. And on basis of this, we can make a lot of assumptions, like not assumptions, but decisions, like if my flow rate reduces below 1000 MCFD, then we will stop that well and we won't produce further on. That is our limit. So that's a decision, right? And we can see that after 5000 days, we will be making that decision, or we will be shutting that well. Yep. Okay. Any questions on decline curve analysis? It's a very
If you've got a Q versus T plot, and in this case you have got very scripts and stabilized flow rates, So what if you have got a scatter flow rate? Will the trend line will be always accurate? Like,
well, that won't be accurate, but then we will be having a lot of data points, right? And through regression, someone mentioned regression, right? So through regression, we can get a very smooth line. Then we can decide if we want to stick with that line or we want to change that model. But if our variance, basically, if you understand variance, is very small, then we can stick with that line.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. We will be discussing some aspects of variance and all if time permits. But that is very interesting, right? Okay. Let's move on to decline curve from this graph. Has anyone seen this graph before? And can anyone tell what is this?
So it's a phase diagram for a black oil. It is used for a PVD characterization. You basically have the pressure versus temperature plot, and the point E is in the reservoir condition, and the F point is in the separator conditions. When the oil is coming out, there is a phase transition where the oil in the liquid phase will move into the two phase region.
Wow, you explained a lot more than I expected because my knowledge about petroleum industry is now getting rusty. But thanks for that. It's very clear. It's an envelope diagram. Yes. It's a phase diagram. Very well mentioned. I'm sure that most of you might be knowing it. So it's a pressure temperature diagram where we can see that in which phase the oil basically will be when we have pressure and temperature combination as per this diagram. So let's say if we are at this point and we want to judge in which phase. I'm missing my arrow. Yeah, at this point, and we want to basically say in which phase our oil will be, then we can very well say it will be in two phase. But if we cross this and we are here somewhere, let's say pressure is increased and temperature has decreased, then we can very well say that it will be in the liquid phase. Yeah. All right, so it's a very crisp diagram and I liked it when I studied it in my college days. Yeah. Then we have something called GGS diagram, group gathering station. We can see that there is a node ring. The square is node where all the well production will be gathering. Yeah, and we can have manifold where, yeah, basically it the gas or oil basically accumulates at the black point first and then goes to the collection center. Right, the line is the pipeline, the empty circle is well. So here we can very well see that how many wells are interlinked, and if we lay this on a map, then it can be very well be used as a geographical information as well, right? But that is one more example of how we can visualize our group gathering station. So if anyone is from electric background, again you will be having similar kind of diagram where we'll be linking our wires and so on. All right, then we have well diagram. You might have already seen the well diagram, and we can very well see that all the casings where it belongs. All the casings and so on, and the depth of the well and so on. So we can make our well diagram very detailed as well, and we can have very simple well diagram as well. This is very simple without the depths even, but we can have depths too, so that we can have the sense of how much deep our well is and at what depth our casing is lying, various casings is lying, and basically at what depth our perforation is there, and we are taking our production. All right, then we can have very very crisp pivot table kind of thing where we can have quarter wise production and so on. Units has not been mentioned, but it's a very good exercise to mention the units as well. Then we have year wise average international crude price for Indian basket, and we can see that this is a real diagram, and we can see that from 2009 to 2016 the prime time was from 2011 to 2013, and this is where I graduated, and then we went downhill very sad story. Okay. Any questions on this slide?
No, sir.
Okay. one more confirmation. Any questions?
No, sir.
All right. We'll move on then. So, Hello, sir. Go on.
Please. Can you repeat again the second diagram, the next diagram before the after the decanker analysis?
After the envelope, you mean?
No,
the group gathering stage.
Yes.
All right. Okay. So the idea is, if you ever have been to any field, production field, then what it does is, we would be having. So the general question comes to anyone's mind is, how do we collect oil from various wells? And this is exactly how it is represented. Let's say this is a well, this is another well, and we have a cluster of five wells. And from those five wells, we are collecting the production from through pipeline into this manifold. And from this manifold, it goes into the node of ring. Yeah, the square box basically. And from there, there would be some way where we'll be moving to the distribution path, or basically to selling it or to processing it. So this is basically a very schematic representation of where our wells are, where our manifolds are, and through pipeline, how it is collected, how the oil and gas is collected. Okay. So there is no data as such, but we can make it very detailed as well. Like for each well, how much pressure that is we are having right now through pipeline as well, and so on. Yes.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
All right. Sure. Great. Okay. Thanks for the question. Let's move on. So what I'll do is. I was planning to take 5 to 10 minutes break every hour, so that we are not we are basically focused. All right. So before we move on to now, we are getting into some good topics, some good theory of data visualization. So before we do that, what we will do is we'll take 5 minutes break, and we will reconvene. In fact, 7 minutes break, and we will reconvene in 7 minutes. Yeah, so Indian time you can see is 3:53, and we can reconvene at 4. Is that okay, Jatin?
Yes, sir.
All right, so we'll take some break. Thanks. Okay, are we back?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we have 65, but anyhow, the session is recorded, so that's a good thing. All right. Okay. All right, so we'll move on. We'll make another sprint for one hour. Okay, so I am again assuming everyone is back and I can start. All right. Okay, so we looked at some of the visualization. Well, they are advanced. They are not just visualization. I saw you. Well, I show you was, but they were infographics, right? And it's a more advanced version where you get very creative. But in general sense, if we see data visualization, okay, this making sure the screen is visible and I am audible.
Yes, sir.
All right. Okay, so I was, All right. So I was saying, from a general sense, when we create dashboard and for business purpose, particularly when you advertise and those things is a different ball game, where you get very creative with visualization. But in my experience, what I have noticed is if we are doing a business presentation, it's generally always very simple. And the graphs we have generally seen. And why is that? Can anyone tell me in a business presentation why I can't use infographics or some complicated visualization?
Sir, that's not catchy enough and that won't attract the person you are presenting to.
Well, if we use infographics, that can be very catchy. But the thing would be, there is no point of explaining a visualization to anyone, right? If you make it very complicated, let's say, let me just give you an example, right? So this visualization, right? What happens if I present this visualization to anyone? I have to explain to them. And it basically loses its purpose if you are in a business meeting and the decisions are to be taken very quickly. Yeah. So to make it very simple, we create very simple charts, what people have already seen. Or if not, if I am presenting this visualization to anyone, I need to make sure that I have explained to them how to read this visualization. And there should be some text as well explaining how to read this visualization. Otherwise, people will be lost for some time at least. Yeah. Okay. Right. So what are the features of good data visualization? So we are now deep diving into some of the critical aspects of what we need to take into consideration when we are designing data visualization, right? So first of all, any data visualization will constitute of four major things. It should be having information. It should be having story. We'll be talking a lot more on stories later. We'll be having a goal in mind. Goal means, from a particular visualization, there has to be one goal, that this goal should be achieved by this visualization, and that should be there, right? It should be visually appealing. It should be beautiful as well. Right? So these are the four major pillars which are mainly used to have a successful visualization. And if you are missing any one of them or two of them, they will be something else. Like if you don't have goal, if you have story, information and visual form, the visualization will be useless because it is not having any goal, right? If you are having story and just visual form, it will be an art because you won't be having information from that, or you are basically doing some rough sketch, right? If we have visual form as well, if we have goal, but it is not having any story, then it will be boring. So story is necessary. Story means when a person looks at a visualization, the end-to-end story or whatever you want to convey in your mind should be clear. Okay. So for example, I have mentioned two examples here. We have this graph. It can be a very well a scatter plot as well. But look how beautifully he or she has presented it. For example, they are showing us water district customer. So these are all the customers. There has to be name, but I have just removed that. And gallons per year. What is the usage, right? So we can see that. Let's consider this is time for now. Yeah. So the usage is increasing, and we can see that your usage is here. The average usage is here, and what is ideal usage is here. So we can see that we are using a lot much than we are expected to or we should. So the story is very clear, like how much you are using, how much you should be using, and how much people are using at just one go. Right. So this is a very efficient visualization. We can have various forms like a line chart or even bar chart and so on, but we can discuss that later. Now look at this. Let's say you are a part of a company and you are having four products. Yeah. And you are making strategy of how you want to sell those products. So now we can see very clearly that strategy one is having product C as the product C as the most sold one, and so on. Product D would be sold very less. Strategy two. So by this picture, you are basically depicting your ideas and strategy to your company. So if you give this graph directly to your sales team or let's say marketing team, they can very well reconnect with this visualization and then can act accordingly. But now consider, instead of this, you are giving them in a tabular format. It will be very boring, and the chances are the process might not be effective. Yeah? They might not be able to sell what you have strategized. So there are various benefits of data visualization. One is to generate interest, to make things very clear, and so on. Yep. Okay. Any questions on this? By the way, just one question from my side. Is it looking interesting, the concept of data visualization?
Yes.
Yes, sir.
All right. So that was kind of a in-session feedback from my side. But all right, great. Let's move on. So we have a very, very big picture. This is one of the I have posted this at my desk in Shell, and this is very beautiful. The thing is, there is a particular instance where you need to use a particular kind of graph or a chart. If you use pie chart instead of line chart, you will miss your story. You will mess up the things. Where line chart is required, you need to make sure that line chart is there. And so we discussed this earlier, right? Where we can use, so in the case of election results, which kind of chart we can use. So this is the page where we can come into and see which kind of graph we can use. Can we use line chart there? No, we can't. Can we use any other kind of graph? Let's say pie chart. Yes, we can use that. But why that is, let's see that. Right? So let's say you have a problem at hand, business problem at hand. And you want to visualize that. What would you like to show? So first it asks you, what would you like to show? Now, if we are making comparisons, yeah, or we are seeing composition. So there in the example of, so if you remember the example of election results, there we were basically, we can do comparison as well, and we can do composition as well. Composition means from a particular, or from the entire part, how much a particular section is composing of, right? So there we can do composition. And if you are doing comparison, like let's say one part is having that much and another part is having that much. So that is a comparison. And there we can use this graphs. I'm not sure how I can do marker or those kind of stuff. That would be very interesting.
Sir, from your left-hand side, you can access it.
from my
left side.
Okay, let's see.
Left bottom. Left bottom. Not in the team. From in the presentation. Yeah.
The page. I'm not able to see.
Please do right click. Then pointer options.
Wow, thanks. Thank you so much.
We'll have a pen.
Yep, great. Thank you. Hey. All right. So we can see that pointer. Okay, let's not get choosy. Okay, so we have comparison and we have composition. I explained to you what is comparison. Comparison means if we are comparing, let's say, two, three more categories side by side. If we have composition from the entire section, how much one section is occupying, or all the sections are occupying one by one. So that is composition. If you are showing distribution, distribution means, let's say, over time, or how much frequency is there for a particular category. So that is distribution. When we have relation means when we have two categories. We'll see examples of that as well. When we have relation between two categories and we want to see relationship between those categories, we can use scatter plot and bubble chart. For example, let me just give you an example. In my last session, some of you might have missed it. Let's say we have a relationship between how much we are spending on a well, how much dollar we are spending on a well, and how much production we are getting from that well. Right. So there certainly has to be a relationship that if we are spending more, we are expecting to produce more. Right. So there has to be a relationship, and that relationship can be very well visualized using a scatter plot. So you saw, right? I just gave you two variables. As in the production and cost. And that's why we selected scatter plot. But if we have, let's say, three. Let's say we have cost, production. Let's say we have three called gas production, oil production, and cost. Right. So there we can use three variables. My mouse is scary, but okay, there we have three variables. I'm hoping you are getting this like this. Oh no, I need a mouse. We have oil production, we have gas production, and here we have bubbles. And the size of the bubble can be shown by the cost. Let's say this bubble, we are spending a lot, so it will be a bigger bubble. Right? So this kind of graph can be very useful for anyone who are making decisions, right? Because if you are producing less oil and gas and you are spending more, that is a cause of worry. If you are producing very, very significant amount of oil and gas and still the bubble is very small, that means you are spending more, that means you are doing good, right? So this kind of relationship can be done using a bubble chart, right? Okay, guys, give me just 1 minute. I'll connect my mouse. Okay. So I'm not able to find my mouse, but that should be all right. Okay. Okay, and now let's deep dive into comparisons. So when we say comparison, we want to compare on one axis, there will be value, and on one axis and on the x-axis, so on the y-axis, there will be value, and on the x-axis, there will be categories. For example, if we want to see countrywide production, so we can see that this is the production of, let's say, USA. This is the production of, let's say, Nigeria. This is the production of, let's say, India, and so on. Yeah, so what we are doing is we are comparing the countries for the production value, and that is why comparison. So you can very well see that if you have, if it is over categories, and we have two values, so we can use something called column chart, but it's not generally used. Where we have one variable per item, so there we can use bar chart and column chart. If we have very few, we can use, well, there is not a lot of difference between column chart and bar chart, but basically if we have a lot many items, we can narrow down the bars and represent that, right? If we have time into consideration, then line is the best chart, I think. When we want to show trends, for example, for just one country only. So here what we see was we have comparison. But let's say for a particular country over time. So this is time, and we want to see the production value. Right? So line chart is the best thing, which will show you that the production is decreasing gradually or it increases and so on. Pretty much for time, I generally use line chart. That is the best thing. Okay, if we are showing distribution means a particular category is occurring how many times, or we are getting frequency. So there we have histogram, which is very basic, which will show you that, let's say, we are giving marks to all the students from 5 to 10 marks. How many students are getting that? From 10 to 20 marks, how many students, and so on. So we can have bint categories over here, and we can show a histogram. So that is when we want to show distribution. Right? We are showing distribution, right? How many marks are distributed among the students? So that is where we use histogram. Now, line chart histogram is a very similar thing when we have many bins, right? Here we have only 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 categories, 5 bins basically. But if we have a lot many, then we can use a line histogram. And you can, well, if you have heard of a bell-shaped curve, then line histogram is the perfect example of that. Right. If you have two variables, as in if we have two bins, let's say we have again oil production, gas production, and we want to distribute it, we can show scatter plot. Now we have some advanced, complicated, so as to say, visualization in the form of 3D area chart and 3D scatter plot as well. But that is used when we have three variables. So let's say condensate production, oil production, and gas production. So if you have three axes, then we can use 3D area chart. But again, that is a very complex visualization, and we need to explain our audience better how to read that. Now, when we want to show composition, the best example is pie chart. Nowadays, mostly used visualization to show composition. If we have many categories, then it's waterfall. And we can have many, like stacked area chart and so on. But if we talk about basic visualization, they are bar chart, line chart, scatter plot, pie chart, and histogram. Histogram is in fact a bar chart again. Okay, but these things should be clear, right? When we want to show distribution, you cannot use pie chart. When we want to show relation, you cannot show bar chart and so on. Well, if you show, then it would be very difficult for any person to perceive that. Yeah, so this is the general guideline or basically overview of how we can make our data visualization effective by selecting it properly. Okay, I'll make sure I'm audible and ask any questions. Is this clear? Any questions till now?
Not yet.
Okay. So we can ignore some things, like I ignored. Well, where is my pointer? Yeah, here. Okay. I specifically ignored this part because I know that it can be very well done using bar chart as well. Yeah. Because if you have two variable per item, you can always color by and show it like this. So whenever we have comparison, I generally prefer bar chart. When it is time bound, I always select line chart, and then we can have variance as well. But if you have distribution, I like to choose scatter plot or histogram. When there is composition, waterfall or pie chart, or even stack chart as well, stack column chart. When it's relationship, definitely scatter plot. Or a bubble chart, depending on if it is two variable or three variable. Right? Then there are some visualization called tree map. Well, there are a lot many. We'll deep dive into that as well. But basically, instead of pie chart, you can have tree map as well. We'll look into that tree map, what tree map is. Okay, I'll move on. But before that, we are getting into data analysis now. I'm just holding my horses back. Any questions? I'll take that right now. Okay. Nope. All right. So now we deep dive into one of the process generating visualization. But before we generate visualization, we need to explore the data. And sometimes visualization is used for exploration of data as well, right? Not just reporting. Let's say someone gave you a data table of let's say 200 columns and 10,000 rows. What will you do then? You cannot go line by line and read and understand the data. You need to first plot some basic visualization in order to see trends or see categories and so on. So that is where visualization comes into picture as well, right? It is not always for reporting purpose, saying that this is the report and make the decision based out of it. No. If you are a data analyst or business analyst, you need to understand your data as well properly. Because without understanding your data, you won't be able to create a proper story around your data and won't be able to create proper visualization. So it is very important to understand data, and there again, visualization can help. All right. So when we talk about any business case, right? We will look into the diagram when we get there, but the basic exploratory data analysis, what it entangles is, we need to source the data first of all. So this is where now the entire picture of the data story will be clear. We need to make sure that we are sourcing the data properly. Again, it can be a private source or a public source. Public source means it is readily available. Private data means it's not readily available. But if you work with that company or that person, you can get the data. Then comes data cleaning. It's a very important step, because if you don't do that, then there will be a lot of outliers and your decision will not be proper. You can make a very skewed decision. So data cleaning is very important. And in data cleaning, when we see, we do a lot of steps, right? We do fixing rows and columns. What does that mean? That means that, let's say, there are some empty rows in between. There are some columns which are not having proper data type and so on. So we fix that first. Now, if there are some missing values, then we fill that missing values or remove that rows completely, right? Depending on your business knowledge. So let's say we have a few values, 2, 3, 5, and so on. And there is a very huge outlier, 200. So we need to, basically, that is an incorrect value. If we see and we understand from a business perspective, if that is an incorrect value, then we need to remove that row altogether. Right? That is incorrect row, incorrect values. Now we might need to standardize some values as well. So let's say if some values are in barrel and some values are in liter, so we need to make sure that all the units are standardized basically, so that we can make comparisons better. Otherwise, there is no point of visualization. So we need to standardize the values again. We talked about incorrect values and then filter data. So when someone gives a data set to you, it is not always necessary that you will be requiring all those 200 columns. No, you might require only 30 to 40, 40 columns from that data. And you need to select that and basically remove other columns. And if we, let's say I just belong to India asset, then I need to filter the data of other countries as well in order to make my report India specific. So that is again filtering the data. So this is the process of data cleaning, which we require before we, before we do any kind of data visualization. So that is the primary objective. Now, when we do exploratory data analysis, we can have univariate analysis, bivariate analysis, and derived metrics. So what does this mean, right? Now, this means that univariate analysis is, let's say, we have only one variable, let's say production, right? We have only one variable, production, and we are doing the analysis. So in that kind of analysis, we can only create histogram or bar chart, saying that, histogram. So we can say that from 10 to 20 barrel, this many occurrences, from 20 to 30 barrel, this many occurrences, and so on, so that we can get a histogram kind of thing. So that is a univariate analysis. It simply means that we have only one variable to analyze, which is production from my example. Now, what if we have bivariate? Let's say we have country as well and production as well. So in that case, we can create very good visualization in a form of bar chart, saying that each country is having how much production total, right? So that is a bivariate analysis. Now we can have derived metrics as well. Derived metrics is, let's say, we have sales number and we have revenue number, but we don't have profit. But profit is one of our major KPI. Major key performance indicator. So we need to create a column called profit, which will simply be in an Excel form, which will simply be is equal to revenue minus sales. Yeah. So that is a formula which will give us a derived matrix. So that means derived matrix, what it means is we by default, we were not having that column or variable already in our data set, but on basis of our business knowledge, we created that column for our further analysis. Yeah. I hope that is clear.
Yes, sir.
All right. Now we move on to this diagram. This is a fantastic diagram which says when we take up any business problem, let's say I have a problem, my asset or my country has a decreasing production year on year. What should I do? Now someone comes to you and say that solve this problem. You will do is you will perform this entire cycle. How? Let's see. First of all, you will collect the raw data in the form of, you will ask him or her that provide me the raw data in the form of how much production year on year from the well and so on. So we will ask for the data. And we will collect the data. Then we will filter, aggregate, and data query It is the format of data cleaning. We will clean the data basically. We will filter out whatever asset is not belonging to us and so on. We will filter the data. We will remove all the columns which are not required for us. We will aggregate the data. Aggregate means if we are not having sum, then we will take sum of that data and so on. Right? Let's say we don't want at a well level, and the data is provided us to well at well level. So what we'll do is we will aggregate at a field level, so that we can have a very good comparison. Data querying simply means whatever we require from the data, we are basically querying that part. Right. Once we have the data intended for us, what we will go, we will be moving into our data exploratory phase. We will first explore our data and see what kind of trends we are seeing. Production is really decreasing or not, or it's just a myth. And if we are having production decrease, which well is decreasing, which well is increasing, which field is the culprit, which is showing a loss of production, a loss of pressure, and so on. So we'll be doing an exploratory data analysis and visualization of the data, right? Now again, if you go to some person and say that 2017 this was the production, 2018 this was the production, 2019 that was the production, no, that does not work. You need to give them a proper visualization in a report format, so that person can make a very good sense out of it, right? So that is data processing. Now coming on to the modeling part, someone asked me machine learning and so on. So machine learning is required when we want to predict something, or we are classifying something or clustering something and so on. So let's say that person has also asked in 2021, what will be the production? Now that challenge cannot be done on the basis of the data that we have already. We cannot say, right, what will be the production of 2021. No, we can't say. For that, we need to model out something. We need to apply some machine learning logic. We might apply regression to that and show them that in 2021 we predict that this will be the production, and on the basis of that production that is predicted, they will take some decision, right? Again, we can have a lot many examples, like how much we are spending, we want to model it out with the production. Then that person who has asked me will directly get a number of cost that we need to invest X USD or X dollar into that well, so that we can have our planned production at the end of 2021. Those kind of questions can also come up, right? Now, once we have done everything, we would like to visualize the results, report it properly,